and gentlemen. My name is Richard McDonald. I'm not a citizen of the United States, and I'm not a U.S. citizen. What I am is a Californian.
Let freedom ring.
That is defined in the Federal Style Manual, Section 5.23, Title 8, Sections 1101A21. Also, everybody get your paper and pencil handy, because I got a few things I want you to write down tonight. Write this down. Handbook of Elementary Law. 1939 by McGray. M-C-G-R-A-Y. And I'm going to read you just a little bit out of it. And you'll understand where the federal government is coming from, where the state government is coming from. This book was published in 1939. In 1941, right after this book was published, California changed their laws to comply with this book. They said, prior to 1939, it said everybody has a domicile. In 1941, they took it and said the word domicile out and replaced it with residence. Okay? Now listen what the court, the law book says. The members of a state. A member of a state may be either a citizen occupying the status called entitled citizenship, or he may be a resident alien occupying the status designated by the title residence. So when you have a residence, you are now occupying a specific title as a resident alien. And there's several court cases that say the same thing. U.S. v. Slater says the same thing. They treat each state in the union as a foreign country on the same equivalent status as of Mexico. For prosecuting you, you're in a foreign country. They're very consistent. But I've been saying that residence was a nasty word, but I didn't know why. I knew what it meant. But I didn't know they had a law that supported what I did until just recently. You know, let me reread that again. A member of a state may be either a citizen occupying the status called citizenship, which I have, or he may be a resident alien occupying the status designated by the title resident.
There's no third option.
They knew exactly what they were doing when they put those words in there. So that's why everybody has a residence. I don't have a residence. I have a home. Certain key words you must always use. You have a home. You have land. Don't have property. You have land. You have several different things. But one of the key things is that you don't use those nasty words. And why should we be state citizens? Because as a state citizen, you are sovereign. You have the absolute right to work if you know how to exercise it. You have the absolute right to do anything you want to do as long as you don't hurt somebody else. I can't hurt him, her. But what I can do, I can hurt the government all I want because they have no rights. The government is without any rights whatsoever. And I can prove that to you in several different case law scenarios, which we'll get to eventually. One of the key things I want to explain to you is that you can do it. How many people have read the paper last week about the deputy up in Ventura County suing because he's suing the county of Ventura because he wants the Social Security number taken off for maintaining false records? Okay? Can be done. There's a lady in Michigan right now that's suing the workplace. She went to work for this company, and she worked 5 months for this company without a Social Security number. Then they fired her. She has three different paycheck stubs with different Social Security numbers that they created and made up for her which is a felony. So when you understand, that's what she's doing. So her case is worth $100,000. Just because they maintained false records, they made phony social security numbers, they violated every law in the books. We got court cases that say this. Now, how well she carries it off, that's, I just heard about, so I'm just passing along to you that what information is available to you, okay? One of the key things when you do a suit against your employer, if you're working for him, if you're not working for him, makes no difference. You do your request for admissions, you do your interrogatories, you do everything you need to do to comply with the law. You obey the law, and you force them to obey the law. They have to obey the law. There's no law requiring, any place that I've been able to find, even I have a letter from the Congressional Research Service that says there's no law requiring anybody to have a Social Security number. If you're not required to have one, why did you get one? My mother got me mine. I didn't know. I was little Todd, you know. Most everybody didn't sign their own Social Security number. It was gotten for them by their parents. So you have the right to cancel that contract. And it is a contract for benefits. They may not, they'll say it's not, but it is. It's an application for benefits. And any application is a contract. Yes. Yes. I don't want anything from the federal government because I don't want them in my hip pocket for the rest of my life. I don't want anything. And anything you paid into Social Security, you can get back if you want to get it back. Yes, you can get it back. But there's only one specific way you can do it. And then there's people that have done it. But you have to be prepared to go all the way. You don't start a battle and then turn tail and run at the last minute. You know what I mean? Just be prepared to move forward all the way down the line. You have to file in court of claims. And then if you prevail at the court of claims, then you will automatically get all the income tax money since day one refunded back to you, plus interest. Because the government's wrote many letters stating if you don't have a Social Security number, you would have no taxable income. When you got your Social Security number, how many people were told you were giving up your sovereignty? How many people were told you're giving up all your rights? How many people were told that you were giving up your right of inheritance? How many people told you giving up the right to work to accept a privilege? You know what I mean? How many people were told that when you got your Social Security number, you're asking for government supervision? How many people were told when you got your Social Security number, you'd pay 52% of your salary for the rest of your life to the government? Yes. Three to 5 years, depending on how well. One guy in Florida did it, took him 9 months. Guy followed him up, took him 4 years. You know what I mean? Followed the same suit, you know what I mean? Depends on how you set your case up. You have to set them up. You do your letter writing campaign, you follow me? And you do this, and you do that. You set them up so that you have all the evidence on your side. And once you have them set up, then you can move forward. Okay. I was going to talk about citizenship a lot tonight, so I brought my big book on citizenship. I was going to talk a lot about citizenship. This book here, which I'll be taking to Texas with me next month, how many people have heard of the U.S. Constitution? There's dirt under my feet. It doesn't apply to me. I got several court cases say the U.S. Constitution doesn't apply except to the federal government. It doesn't apply to the state government. It only applies to the state government through the 14th Amendment. So anytime you use the U.S. Constitution, then you are accepting the benefits and privileges of the 14th Amendment. Unless you're in federal court. If you're in federal court, then you can use it all the way down the line. But in state court, you cannot, unequivocally, you cannot use the U.S. Constitution. Steve knows what I'm talking about.
Well, I was going to say, by extension, you wouldn't want to use federal case citations and such either.
No, you don't use federal cases in state court because that also brings in the 14th Amendment. It only applies to the 14th Amendment.
But they'll drag you there.
Oh, yeah, yes, they will. They'll try to drag you over there. One of the key things you have to learn and remember is that the courts have all said that the state constitution is the sky's the limit on your rights. The federal constitution is the floor. So you want the bare basics or you want the unlimited side?
Well,